just have to take a moment and tell you that I can't express what a joy it is to have been here for my first trip to Australia and have such a warm reception. People have been so kind and so friendly. They've dragged me off to the deepest forest and the deepest gold mines and have done their dead level best to lose me, and here I am. I've been blessed to be here today and to make a connection with this church. God has privileged me to travel all over the world, and I have friends in every corner of the globe, and I continue to make new friends, and it's just, there's nothing like it. And so I want to say thank you for welcoming me into your fellowship. Thank you to the men yesterday for the great time that we had. You know, one day, you can find the record in the book of Acts, chapter 9. There was a man who was riding along the road to Damascus. His name was Saul of Tarsus. You remember him. He was a violent opponent of this new upstart religion, this new faith that had risen up within Judaism. And he was bound and determined to resist it at all cost. He was going to put an end to it. And as the story goes, he had a satchel full of arrest warrants. He was going to ride down to Damascus, where he heard a bunch of these upstarts were hiding. He was going to arrest them. He was going to have them thrown into prison. And that would be the end of it. Unfortunately, along the way, he had an encounter with someone he didn't quite expect to meet. You remember the story. Suddenly as he rode, there was a flash of light and his steed rose up and threw him off onto the dusty road between Jerusalem and Damascus. And he met the Lord Jesus, who announced to him, I want to point out to you, who announced to him that he would be taking the gospel to the Gentiles. Of all things to say to a Jew of the Jews, you are going to be taking my gospel that you hate to the Gentiles. And I must show you what things you must suffer for my sake. And rising up out of the dust of that road was a man that we now call Paul. And for the next 32 years, he committed himself to preaching the gospel. Most of what you believe as a Christian, most of our theology, we got from Paul. Because from that place, the Lord took him into the Arabian desert. He lived there for a period of time where he was taught by the Holy Spirit. And he came back, joined himself to the church, which he had so persecuted for so long, and became such a powerful representative of the Lord Jesus. In the scripture that Peter read for you tonight in 2 Timothy, we have the last will and testament of this old war horse. He's been all over Asia and even forays into Europe. He has overseen the establishment of churches and raising up leaders and strengthening those churches. He has friends in every corner of the known world. He also has enemies in every corner of the known world. And now he's languishing in a prison in Rome and he's preparing to die. Oh, he's been arrested before. He's been arrested many times. Actually, he was arrested at one time when he wrote to Timothy a book that we call 1 Timothy. He was under house arrest. It was kind of a nice, pleasant affair. It wasn't too bad. He had his own home. He could pretty much come and go as it pleased. Apparently, the only restriction that was on Paul in that first arrest that was recorded in 1 Timothy, or was the time 1 Timothy was recorded, was that he was required to be chained to two members of the Praetorian Guard in 8-hour shifts, 24 hours a day. He had an unwilling audience to hear the gospel. Hey, fellas, since we're here, because it's recorded that during his time in Rome, an unusual number of the Praetorian Guard were converted to Christ. I wonder how that happened. You know, I want to say to you tonight, it doesn't matter what circumstances you find yourself in, you can be a servant of the living God, whether in prison or a free man. So Paul is writing now to Timothy, who he sent to Ephesus to to strengthen the church at Ephesus. Timothy's at Ephesus, and Paul is writing to him. Paul is saying to him, and if I may shorten it, and by the way, you said I needed to be done by 7 o'clock. That's going to be hard. That's what you said. I'm sorry? 30. Okay, good. I can do that. I can do that. All right. I'm thinking, boys, it's going to be hard. Anyway, so Paul is no longer in a nice house where he's under arrest. He's in a hole in the ground. They throw his food down through a grate in the top. He's in the dark. He has to write by the light that comes through. And he's scribbling off this letter. He's writing, imagine him, if you will, furiously, trying to get to so that someone can take this letter to Timothy. And he wants to encourage Timothy. And here's the reason he wants to encourage Timothy so much. Because he understands now that the baton is going to be passed to a new generation. He says to Timothy in the latter parts of this book, I've finished my course. I'm ready to be offered. The time of my departure is at hand. And so I want to pass on to you, my son. You're my son in the Lord. I want to pass on to you some information that I want you to hold on to, and I want you to guard the treasure that has been deposited to you. As a matter of fact, if you look down in 1 Timothy or 2 Timothy 1, in the passage that Peter read, Paul says this to young Timothy. He says, follow the pattern of the sound words that you have heard from me in the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus by the Holy Spirit who dwells within us. Guard the good deposit or treasure that has been entrusted to you. This passage of Scripture burns in me every day. There are a few themes that I think are so critical in this day, and this is one of them. I'm going to share with you some things that Paul reveals in this rich passage that I think are important for the day in which we live. There are several things that Paul alludes to, he speaks about, but that are very important for us to realize. The first thing Paul says, that Paul recognizes, is that this ministry of the gospel is a multi-generational project. This is not for a single generation. This is for something that is to be received, grown in, guarded, entrusted, and then given to another generation. You know, he says, I serve God as my forefathers did. And then he says, I remember your faith, Timothy, which was first in your grandmother Eunice, and then, as if I got them different there, your grandmother Lois, and then your mother Eunice, and then now in you. And so Paul recognizes that this message, this gospel, this ministry is a multi-generational thing. I'm telling you, I believe with all of my heart, I'm living it out right now with my son as I'm passing on the ministry to him. If a man has a vision that he can fulfill in his own lifetime, it's not from God. It's too small. If a man has a vision that he can fulfill by himself, it's too small. It's not from God. We see all through the Scriptures how God deals with generation after generation after generation, and he ties them together. And one generation prepares the next, and one generation communicates to the next. Paul recognized this was a multi-generational endeavor. The second thing Paul recognized is that this ministry of the gospel is a cross-cultural ministry. And by cross-cultural, I don't mean like you have here, cross-cultural, as there are many cultures. I mean that this message of the gospel from time to time runs directly across the culture. It doesn't flow with the culture. The early church was born into adversity. It was born literally into persecution. It was born into a hostile environment. It was born right into a generation that tried to snuff it out from the very beginning. And it's always running across grain with the culture. We were designed to do that. We were designed to speak the word of God, which always runs at odds with the mind of the world. I think the worst thing that ever happened to the church was when one day Constantine put his arm around the church and said, let's be buddies. Let's be friends in the church instead of being countercultural. Maybe that's the word I should use instead of cross-culture. Countercultural. We became a part of the culture and we began to flow with the culture, and the church has lost its conscience, and therefore the world no longer has a voice, truly, in many cases, speaking for righteousness. The other thing that Paul recognized is that the ministry of the gospel is a holy trust. It is, he calls it a treasure. A treasure. You know, this ministry, the ministry of the word, is a treasure. It brings life. It brings hope. It brings deliverance to those who are bound. It brings light to those who are in darkness. It brings hope to those who have lost hope. It gives answers to those people who only have questions. This is a wonderful trust. And Paul says to Timothy, first this was entrusted to me. Jesus intercepted me on the road to Damascus. Jesus captured me on the road to Damascus. Jesus bound me up in his own chains of love on the road to Damascus. And then he entrusted to me this rich and marvelous truth. He revealed to me things that men don't see in the natural. He allowed me to see it in the spiritual and to possess it, but not only to possess it, but to be possessed by it. It was entrusted to me. And now, Timothy, I entrust it to you. I'm leaving. I'm departing. I'm moving on to my reward. So now, as I vacate this life, I'm entrusting this to you. You'll notice something over in chapter 2. If you have your Bibles, you can look there, but I'll tell you what it says. Over in chapter 2, verse 2, Paul says to Timothy, this same truth that you have heard from me and seen in me, confirmed among many witnesses, this same truth you commit also to faithful and steady men who will be able to teach others what I have taught you. So we see Paul saying, I have guarded the treasure. I've kept it. He says at the end of the book, I've kept the faith. I haven't abandoned it. I haven't become discouraged and turned away from it. I haven't found other things to do. I've kept the faith. And now, Timothy, I deposited in you. And now I want you to deposit in others. Because one day, Timothy, you're going to be where I am. One day, Timothy, they're going to come. And it was perfectly within the context of the life in which they were living. You're going to share in the sufferings that I have had. They're going to come and they're going to take you, and they're going to come and throw irons on you, and they're going to try to silence the gospel. But if you are faithful and commit to other men, the gospel can never be silenced. Paul says it was first entrusted to me, and then it was Paul entrusted it to Timothy, and then he encourages Timothy to be faithful to entrust it to other men. The key to this passage, I believe, is verse 14, in which Paul reveals his purpose for writing. In verse 14, he says, by the Holy Spirit who dwells within us, guard the good deposit entrusted to you. I hope that you realize when you come into this place and pastor or one of the elders stands up and they begin to teach you, begin to expound the scriptures, begin to explain, you don't just come here. What a great worship we had a few minutes ago. Amen. That was sweet, guys. Thank you so very, very much. We should come together and we should sing and we should celebrate and we should worship God. But there's another element to the reason we come together. There's a treasure that's being deposited in you. I hope when you walk out of here, when I preach or when Peter preaches or anyone else, you walk out realizing treasure has been entrusted to me. These are not just words that I can nod my head, shake the preacher's hand and say that was a really good message. I like the way you deliver the message. You're really a lot of fun to listen to, or you're really stimulating, and that's great. No, there's something much greater has happened here. You've got a deposit now that has been brought from one life and deposited in you. And Paul says, Timothy, guard that treasure. Guard that treasure. He says that we are to guard the integrity of the Word of God. There's never been a day in which this book and the integrity of this book has been under challenge as the way that it is. You know, in the book of Ephesians, it says that there are demonic forces, they call them authorities, that are working in the world today. And I really believe that the major work of those demonic authorities is to challenge the authority of the Word of God. I don't know if you're seeing it here in Australia, but we're certainly seeing it in America, where the world is saying, and governments are saying, and organizations that are committed to unrighteousness are saying, the Word of God has no validity in our society. The Word of God has no relevance. It doesn't not have authority. And so the authority of the Word of God, the integrity of the Word of God. There are nations in the West right now who have put the Bible on a list of hate literature. Because you teach hatred. This book teaches hatred because it does not allow men to live as they want to. And that, of course, today is hate. If you don't agree with everything that I do and everything that I am, then you obviously hate me and you want to destroy me, and so I must oppose you. So this, the integrity of this book is being challenged. I saw a movie producer just this week who produced a movie that challenges righteous doctrine. He said, there are pages in the Bible I'd like to tear out. I don't like what it says. It doesn't agree with my view of the world, so I want to tear it out. So the integrity of the Word of God, the authority of the Word of God. There's a challenge even to the message of the Word of God. As the emergent church arises in the world today, and they're saying there's no need for repentance, there's no need for confession of sin, everybody's going to be saved, God is so good, He wouldn't send His own creatures to hell, and so therefore, it's all good. There's no judgment. And I sit and think, if there's no judgment, if there's no hell, if there are no consequences for our sin, why in the world did God send Jesus to the cross? I read an author the other day, and this is what he said. He said, if God conceived of the cross, then He is a cosmic child abuser. The message of this book and the message of the atonement is under open assault today. And we are urged and pressured to shape, reshape, and rewrite and edit the Word of God. I'm a writer, and one of the things I tell people all the time, I said, I write something and I have absolute editorial privilege on it. I can rewrite it, I can erase, I can take words out, I can put words, I can do anything I want to with it. But I do not own editorial privileges to the Word of God. I'm not allowed to rewrite it. I'm not allowed to shape it to my own feelings. I can't sit in judgment of the Word of God. I simply must receive the message and communicate it. But there's another purpose for which Paul writes. And it's found over in verse 9 of chapter 2. And I want to read it for you. I didn't have Peter read it for you, but I want to read it for you. Because Paul is writing to Timothy, and he says in verse 8 of chapter 2, he says, remember Jesus Christ, risen from the dead, the offspring of David, as preached in my gospel, for which I am suffering, bound with chains as a criminal, but the word of God is not bound. Powerful. That's a victory cry. Paul says, look, here I am. I'm in chains for preaching the gospel. I've been dragged into prison. Caesar's decided he's going to shut me up once and for all, and he's going to put me in this hole in the ground, and he's going to cut me off from the world, and he's going to chain me up, and that's going to silence the word of God. But notice what Paul says. He says, I'm chained as a common criminal, but the Word of God is not bound. You know why the Word of God wasn't bound? Because Paul had entrusted it to Timothy. Paul had entrusted it to Jude. Paul had entrusted it to Luke and to John Mark and to others. And so the cat was already out of the bag. Chain me up, cut my head off, but the Word of God is not bound. That was his victory cry from prison. Men have sought to silence the Word, to change the Word, to pervert the Word, to dilute the Word. He said, I've been beaten, I've been whipped, I've been stoned, I've been shipwrecked, I've been cast out, and now I'm in prison, that the Word of God might be bound. You know, when Peter and John walked up to the temple by the Gate Beautiful, remember that early in the book of Acts, they came across a man who was lame from his birth. He'd been sitting there his whole life, shaking his little cup, asking for donations. And Peter had probably walked by him a dozen times or more. And all of a sudden, one day, something gripped Peter's heart. And he looked at that man and he said, I don't have any money. But what I do have, I give you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. And he grabbed him by the hand and he pulled him up and he began to leap around the gates of the temple and everybody came running from everywhere. What in the world is going on? We've never seen anything like this. Are these men gods? How do they have such power? And Peter began to preach the gospel. And so the temple police came and they were arrested and they were beaten and they were examined. And cross-examined and questioned again. And here was the question. By whose name or by what power have you done this thing? Peter said, I'm so glad you asked. Can I share something with you? This is really not in my thing, but this is so important. The miracles in the book of Acts, all of those manifestations of the power of God. We, you know, humans like shiny things. We like things that get our attention. We like spectacular things. We like amazing things, right? And so we sort of trend toward the miraculous. We talk about the Holy Spirit. We want to see miracles. We want to see lame men walk. And we want to see blind men see. And we want to see things done that we've never seen before. And when we get excited, we start holding healing conferences. And we start holding prophecy panels. And we start holding miracle conferences. And we miss the whole point. God gave the Holy Spirit and those miraculous things to create a platform from which to preach the gospel. Every time those guys did a miracle, people came running from everywhere and said, what is this? And he said, oh, let us tell you about Jesus. That happened on the day of Pentecost and it followed every day after that. They didn't use the miracles as a means of impressing everybody. They used the miracles for the purpose of drawing a crowd so they could preach the gospel. Let me tell you something. Healing does not save a soul. Miracles do not save a man for eternity. Only the gospel of Jesus does. We need to stop preaching miracles. We need to stop preaching prophecy. We need to stop preaching all of these manifestation things and utilize them for what they were intended to be. And that's an opportunity to preach the gospel to men who are lost. That's free. You don't even have to pay for that. Now, so they're dragged in and the Sanhedrin, notice what they said. They didn't say, you shall not heal anymore. They didn't say, stop doing miracles. They said, stop preaching in the name of Jesus. See, they didn't care what they did as far as miracles or healings or anything else. That wasn't the issue for them. You must stop preaching the name of Jesus. And let me tell you, in the world today, they don't care what you do here as long as you don't mention the name of Jesus out there. There is an effort to silence the message of the gospel. We don't want to hear it. Because it convicts us to our deepest core. So they were trying to silence the gospel, and Paul was so jubilant, sitting in the shadow of the executioner's sword. He was so jubilant. He said, Caesar, you have failed. You have put me in prison, but it's too late. I've already released the gospel in the lives of those men that I've entrusted it to. Always has been. From the moment Satan challenged Eve in the garden, hath God said? Oh no, you're misunderstanding it. We have to apply it a different way. Oh, don't, God's not being honest. You can't believe what God has to say. God's not being truthful to you. Nothing's changed. The same source of all lies is still telling the same lies. Don't trust God's word. And I'm here tonight to tell you that Paul's message to Timothy was, Timothy, always trust the Word of God. Never compromise the Word of God. Never back down from what God has said. Never apologize for the Word of God. But speak it. I think it was Spurgeon who said, defending the Word of God is a lot like defending a lion. You don't need to defend the lion, just open the cage. The lion will defend himself. We're locked in this battle today. Men want to silence the word of God. They want to bind it up in chains. Paul pleaded with Timothy and to us, guard the treasure. Do not allow the word of God to be bound. We've been entrusted with a holy treasure, a good deposit. Now, very quickly, so I can get done at 7 o'clock, I want to share with you four ways that Paul reveals that we can actually bind the word of God. We can actually allow the word of God to be bound and to curtail its effectiveness. First one is found in verse 7 of chapter 1. Paul says to Timothy in verse 7, I want to remind you to fan into the flame the gift of God which is in you through the laying on of hands. For God gave us a spirit, not of fear, but of power and love and a sound mind or self-control. Paul said, you have not been given a spirit of fear. Now, let me just share with you that the word fear here, that is translated fear here, the English language is very limited. The Greek language and the Hebrew language are much more descriptive. The word here is not phobia. You know what a phobia is? I talked about a phobia the other day. A phobia is walking 1,000 feet into a cave that's about this big in the middle of the earth and feeling like you can't breathe. A phobia is seeing a spider and climbing to the top of the furniture in your house. Phobia is being afraid of the dark. Phobia is having that terrifying, binding fear. That's not the word that is used here. The word that is used here literally is translated timidity or timid. Do you know when a man is timid? You know what he does? A man who is timid sits down when he should stand up. He goes to the back of the room when he should come to the front of the room. He shuts up when he should speak up because he's timid. He's afraid maybe he doesn't speak well. He's afraid maybe he'll get his theology messed up. He's afraid perhaps that he won't say the words right. I've had people say to me they didn't witness to their friends because they were afraid they would do it wrong and they would turn them off and they become timid and they won't speak up. They get in a crowd of people who are blaspheming the name of Jesus and they're too timid to stand in defense of him. They don't want to speak up. They don't want to speak out. They don't want to stand out. They don't want to look different from the crowd. They don't want to be seen, perceived as being different or weird or odd. Do you know the Word of God says we're peculiar? It does. Peter said, he said, you're a peculiar people. Now, I know some Christians have made an art form out of that. But the word peculiar doesn't mean weird here. It means special. We are peculiar to God. We are a possession of His that is unlike any other possession. So Paul said to Timothy, and Timothy was known to be a little timid. He was young. And often he came under attack because of his youth. And maybe sometimes he felt, well, maybe I shouldn't speak up because I'm very young and I'm very inexperienced. And maybe I don't have a right to speak to those people who are older than me or smarter than me or anything else. And Paul said, Timothy, God did not give you a spirit of timidity, but He gave you a spirit of power. Let me tell you something to those of you who may be timid. You may be timid about speaking the Word of God because you are fearful about your own power. Can I say to you that the power of the message of the gospel is in the message, not the messenger? Even the most timid, even the most awkward, even Moses stuttered. And even those who feel that they have nothing to offer, you have been lied to by the enemy that you are not adequate. Let me settle that. You're not. Get over it. Someone said to me one time, I don't want to work in the gospel because I don't feel like I'm worthy. And I said, well, let me help you out. You're not. You have not ever been worthy to speak the name of Jesus. You are not now worthy to stand and speak for Him. You will not ever be worthy of what God has done. But we don't speak out of worthiness. We speak out of His worthiness, His message, His authority, His power. man said to me one time, he was in Africa and he saw a man walking down through the grasslands. I'm watching it down through the grasslands, and he was carrying a staff, and he was walking in a very regal way. And the man looked at him and he said, "Well, he's kind of ratty. He's all in rags and he smells and he's got sheep, you know, stuff all over him." And he asked his friend, he said, "Who is this guy?" And he said, "Oh, he's nobody." He said, "Well, if he's nobody, why are all the village running to the middle and they're yaping, they're clapping and they're waving at him and they're going?" And he says, "Well, you see that staff that he's carrying, that stick in his hand?" He says, "Yeah." He said, "That is the staff of the primary chief. And he's on a mission for the primary chief. And as long as he carries that staff, people will show him the respect. They will give him the honor. They will give him the audience, just as if the primary chief were speaking." And that man stood there and said, "Wow, that's what the name of Jesus is to the believer. It's the staff of the primary chief." And so I may not be anybody. I may not have no standing. I may not have an education. I may not have any wealth. I may not dress well. I may not speak well. I may not do any of those things. But I don't have to be timid, because it's not my message. It's his message. And he doesn't have to empower me. He empowers his word. And the word of God has great power. The word of God has the power to change lives, no matter who the messenger is. Now there's a second way, Paul says, down in verse 8. Down in verse 8, he says, "Therefore do not be ashamed of the testimony of our Lord, nor of his prisoner, of me, his prisoner, but share in the suffering of the gospel of the power of God." He was saying, Timothy, your father, your spiritual father, is a convict. You might feel ashamed because I've been dragged off into jail. He said, "Don't be ashamed of me. And don't be ashamed of the gospel that has brought me to this place." You know, do you know what happens when a man feels shame? He gets timid. And when he gets timid, he sits down and shuts up. He says, "Don't be ashamed." Listen, the world's trying to shame us. There's something weird about us. There's something odd about us. There's something weird about this blood stuff and cross stuff and righteousness and sin and judgment and all those things. What's wrong with you people? You're not enlightened. You're not intelligent. You're some kind of caveman that walks around with these archaic things. Another preacher that's getting very well known today, I heard him say the other day, someone was asking if the church was making progress, and he said, "The church will never be relevant to this culture until they stop depending on letters that are 2,000 years old." What was he saying? He said, "I'm ashamed of this book. I'm ashamed of the stand that it takes. I'm ashamed of the exclusiveness of it. And so we need to change it." And Paul said, "Don't be ashamed of the gospel." Listen, I'm not ashamed of the one who came and took on human flesh for me. I'm not ashamed of the one who went to the cross and bore my death. I'm not ashamed of the one who shed his blood for me. I'm not ashamed of the one who overcame death, hell, and the grave on my behalf. I'm not ashamed of the one who took my place in judgment. And you can shame me all you want, but you will never make me ashamed of him. Because he's the only one who speaks life. There's another thing that happens, and I call it generational irresponsibility. And let me just very quickly say about this. Paul said to Timothy, "The same things you have seen and heard from many that have been confirmed among many witnesses, you commit also to steady, faithful men who will be able to teach others." In many cases, we have failed to communicate that message to the next generation. I really believe that the failure starts more at home than it does in the church. I spoke to the men yesterday morning, and to the men I said the following things. I believe the home is the center of the kingdom of God. I believe it's in our homes that our children need to hear the word of God. I believe it's in our homes that children need to learn to pray. I believe that it's in our homes at the feet of their fathers that children need to learn about Jesus. They need to learn about God. They need to learn about all the things that God has done for us. And that command is all the way through scriptures. They build altars
altars of stone so that children would ask questions. And when questions were asked, their fathers were ready to give an answer. And men today, and I speak to the men once again, men have abdicated that responsibility. The home has jobbed out the responsibility of teaching their children. And so what's happened is we have a third generation that does not remember the God of their fathers, because their fathers have never spoken of the God that they claim to believe in. And we have failed generationally. I teach men all over the world. I stand in Africa, I stand in South America, Central America, and now Australia, and say to you, we have a generational responsibility. And if we do not fulfill that responsibility, the Word of God will be bound. We will have a generation. They have said to me in America that we have, for the first time, we have a generation of human beings that have no spiritual memory. They have no contact with the gospel of Jesus. They've never been to a summer camp. They've never been to a VBS. They've never been inside the church. They've never heard the name of Jesus aside from a swear word. They have no idea what the church believes. They have no spiritual memory. It's gone. And the reason it's gone is that we have failed in our homes to honor Christ. Fathers have failed to be the spiritual leaders in their home. And I, for one, and every opportunity I get, we need to be faithful generationally. We have many pastors who pastor churches, long and fruitful pastors. They never prepare another generation to step in into their place. They're building sometimes their own kingdom. I love it when I go into a church such as this. I was on Tassie the other day, and I was preaching in a church, and I saw a group of young children, not even as old as these folks. You're not old, are you? You're like, what, 17, 18? Yeah, you believe that, huh? Little girls and little boys standing on the stage leading the congregation of worship. You know what? They weren't great musicians. They had a lot to learn. But you know, something rose up inside of them and they said, I want to worship. I want to lead the body of Christ in worship. And God bless Brother Jeff Weston, who's getting out of the way and letting these kids take the lead in ministry. That's generational responsibility. My own spiritual father, who adopted me just much like Paul did to Timothy, he was generationally responsible. When I left his home and when I went off to college, I had been prepared. I had been taught. It had been modeled for me what a godly man looks like. I didn't have to wonder what it was, because he had shown me. And when I didn't walk in the steps that I should, he corrected me, he disciplined me, he reproved me. And he said, I do this because I love you and I want you to guard the treasure of the Word of God. So we've been generationally irresponsible. And the last one is this. I call it personal negligence. You know, Paul said to Timothy in chapter 2, verse 15, he said, study to show yourself approved, a workman unto God, who needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Men and women, if you're going to teach your children, you need to know the Word of God. Having a Bible on your lampstand by your bed at night and reading it just before you fall asleep is not studying the Word of God. Coming to church on a Sunday morning and hearing great preaching is not studying the Word of God. Studying the Word of God. I was talking to one brother here this morning. Where are you? Thank you. There you are. All right. I was out of here. I'm trying to greet people. I'm trying to say hi. And he's here. Hey, let's do a Bible study. I want to know about this word here. Let's go a little bit deeper. I said, praise God for you, brother. You were a little irritated this morning, but I'm really happy for your heart. No, listen, I'm picking on you, but I'm blessed when a young man says, I want to go deeper in the Word of God. I don't want to just read the surface of it. I want to go deeper. I want to find out about the history. I want to find out about the context. What was Paul thinking when he was sitting in that prison? What was the heart of his message? Let's go deeper. You know, you can never get to the bottom of this. I don't care how smart you are or how long you study it or how many times you preach it. There is no bottom to this book. There's nobody who's got it. There's nobody who says, I don't have anything else to learn from this book. I understand it all. Well, you've missed the heartbeat of it. God says, my ways are not your ways, and my thoughts are not your thoughts. And every time you think you've wrapped your little head around me, I'll show you something you've never seen before. And so we have people who listen to guys on television, and they speak heresy. And people go, oh, isn't that wonderful? That's a new theology. I've never heard that theology before. I just love new theology. Can I share something with you? You'll probably throw me out for this. If you hear something that's new, probably not true. And if it's true, it's not new. God has sealed up the wealth of His wisdom in the Word of God, and it is the measuring stick by which we measure everything. If you hear a guy on television and what he's preaching does not match up to that book, throw it out. Because that's the standard. That's the ruler. That's the thing by which we measure everything. It's the authority. It's the final word. It takes precedence and authority over every other word. And Paul said it probably best. He said, if I come, or even an angel comes and preaches another gospel than this gospel that I preach, do not listen to them. Do not receive it. We need to be personally diligent about studying the Word of God, so that you can intellectually and emotionally engage in the ministry of the Word. And so that when you're out there in the marketplace, you can have an impact. I had a man say to me one time, Pastor, I've got a terrible problem. It's just eating me up, and I don't know what to do about this problem. Could you give me some counsel? I said, well, what's the problem? And he started telling me this silly little thing that was going on in his life that had him all worked up. And so I said, well, wait a minute. What does the Word of God say about this? His answer to me was, I don't know. My answer to him was, not acceptable. Do you know what Muslims call Christians? People of the book. Except that we're not. We're people of the preacher. We're people of the television set. We're people who read books about the Bible but never get around to reading the Bible. And I want to encourage you to be personally diligent in studying the Word of God. Because when you don't know the Word of God, the Word of God is bound. So, thank you for allowing me to be here this week and this weekend. It's been such a privilege. I hope this has been helpful to you tonight. I just want to stir up again in you a love for the Word of God, a willingness to defend the integrity and the authority of the Word of God. Stand on the Word of God and don't let anybody make you ashamed or timid or whatever. This book that I speak of tonight has great power and great authority, and it can silence kings and it can open up nations to the hearts of God if we will be courageous in speaking. So God bless you. Thank you for having me. Thanks for coming tonight. I know it's hot. I'm about to sweat to death up here. But praise God, I've enjoyed being with you. I see people coming back, so they're going to sing, I guess. And then I'm going to get out of the way. Yes.